Good evening, everybody. God bless you. Welcome on this midweek Bible study Wednesday night. Kingdom Worship Center Bible Study Online. So glad to have you. I hope you enjoy this song tonight by Fred Hammond.
You're going to be blessed.
We're blessed. Now, I want you to put that up on the screen tonight. We're blessed. Declare the blessing of God over your life. Enjoy this song as you're coming on. I see Aim on already. God bless you, Aim. And many will come on. We'll just enjoy the music as we wait for people to come on. Again, Fred Hammond, we're blessed. Put it up on the screen. I'm blessed.
Praise God. God bless you.
Coming on, we're just waiting on more to come on tonight. Again, enjoy this beautiful song, We're Blessed by Fred Hammond. Maybe you'll put up on the screen that you're blessed. Amen. We're blessed. We serve a great God, an awesome God, a God of promise. Enjoy the rest of the song, everybody. Everybody, we could listen to the rest of that song. There's such a great joy on that song and a great blessing on that song and a great confession of faith. Praise God. I like what Mike said, just said, filled to the brim with blessings. Amen. Yes, absolutely. We are filled to the brim. Praise God. And the blessing of God is sure and true. I hope you're having a good start to your week, everybody. And God bless you. Thank you for all your greetings and your hellos and your kind words. What a blessing you all are. Praise God. And tonight we're going to be digging into the Word. You know, I always try to put a song to match what I'm going to teach on tonight. So you know I'm teaching on the blessing tonight and that we are blessed. So again, thank you so much for joining me, everybody. I love you all so much. And once again, I hope you're having a great start to your week. Praise God. Hey, there's my good friend, Paul Riley. God bless you, sir. Great to see you online. Haven't seen you in so long, but God bless you and your beautiful family. Praise God. And there's Linda on and others. We just thank God. Patricia, thank you so much. And I know I saw Diane coming on and Claver and Anthony. Praise God. If you have your Bible tonight, open it up. We are going to go to a bunch of scriptures. And there's Danny. Danny, what an honor to have you on tonight. You're down enjoying some R&R in Florida. What an honor to have you on, sir. Praise God. Tonight, I want to teach you on the blessing, but I want to teach you how to really get the blessing, how to get the blessing in your life. I'm going to give you three pointers on how to really obtain God's blessing or to get the blessings of God fulfilled in your life as we dig into the word of the Lord tonight. Praise God. So let's get into it. And you can turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. We will start there in that verse, and then we will go into a few other verses tonight also. But I want to see you blessed. I know you were saying I'm blessed, but I want to see even more blessed. And God is unlimited. There's no limit to God. And there's no limit to how much of God's promises we can have fulfilled in our lives. There's no limit to it. We can have all the promises of God because all of the promises are yes and amen to the glory of his name. And so there's over 1,000 promises in the scripture, and there's no limit to how many we can ascertain or to receive from the Lord. Praise God. Thank you for putting that up on the screen, everybody. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 is where we're going to start tonight. Let's talk about the blessing. Let's talk a little bit about the blessing, and then let's get into talking about three keys to fulfilling God's promise and blessings in our lives. You know, blessing, the word blessing is highly used in our Christian vocabulary, isn't it? You hear it all the time in church. I'm blessed. God wants you blessed. I'm walking in the blessing. Praise God. I'm blessed to be a blessing. So we've heard, I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. I'm blessed when I come in. I'm blessed when I go out. We use that word bless and blessing and blessed quite extensively in the church in our Christian vocabulary. Amen. And why not? Because it's such a great word. Why not? Because it's a wonderful promise of God. And again, I want you to put up on the screen and type it in there. I am blessed of the Lord, because that's a confession of faith. And we sing about the blessing. Do you know that the word blessed, blessing, and bless appears hundreds of times in your script, in the scriptures? Like 600 something times just in the Old Testament. So hundreds of times in the Bible talks about God's blessing or the blessings of God in the life of his children. Praise God. Now I want you to get in your mind right away, God wants you blessed. He wants all of us blessed. Praise God. And he declares it. Even Jesus in the Beatitudes talked about how to be blessed and walking in the blessing. And so it is used in our Christian vocabulary. It is in hundreds and hundreds of verses. So there is a great truth to the blessing of God, and it's a great promise to be blessed, and we can have it, and we can have all of it, like I just said. There's no limitation. God doesn't cut you off. Well, you got 10 promises, that's all you get. Or 25 promises, and that's all you get. Not with God. You can get them all. Praise God. And but so many people feel like they chase after the blessing, or they're trying to chase down the blessings of God, and sometimes feel like they don't get them. And people get frustrated. As a pastor now for 30 years, I've seen people get frustrated because they're wondering, why am I not being blessed? Why are other people being blessed? Why am I not getting that? Why are they getting that? And those are good questions. Good questions. It's not that God doesn't want you blessed, family. He wants you blessed. Again, he wants you to get what he has promised. And a lot of times people are trying to chase them down with no avail. Well, number one, it's not our first point, but it's a good point. You weren't designed to chase something you already have. So again, you were not designed to chase something that you already have. Praise God. And so let's go to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. The Bible says, that according as his divine power that has given us all things to that pertain to life and to godliness. That is one of my favorite verses in your Bible. Praise God. According as his divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and to godliness. Now, I'd memorize that scripture. I'd get that scripture into your spirit because it is so wonderful. God gave me that years and years ago, and I have held on to that verse. Amen. And it is such a blessing, that verse, because the Bible says God has already given us all things. Well, Pastor, if I have it all, why am I not seeing it? Well, we're going to talk about that tonight. Praise God. The blessing is available to you. Amen. The promises of God are available to you. They are yours, and they are part of your birthright in Christ. Now that you've come to Christ, you have a birthright, just like Esau had a birthright, but he gave it away, and Jacob took it. Isaac had a birthright. You have a birthright in Christ, and it's yours. But there are certain things that we must follow in order to obtain that. So, you know, it's there for you. God's given you the power to get it all. So, okay, according as his divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. And that's what Danny's saying, claim it and expect it. You're right, Danny, claim it and expect it. So many Christians don't go beyond the cross. And so many Christians are content with the benefits of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus in the context of the remission and removal of sin and eternal life, but then don't go beyond that moment of the cross into the vast horizons of opportunity that God affords to us as believers and as his children. So they're like, well, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. That's all I need. But there's more to this contract of salvation and this guarantee and this birthright for all of us. And it's available to us, and his power has given it to us. So when it comes to finances, when it comes to healing, when it comes to relationships, when it comes to happiness and contentment and joy, when it comes to promotion or a godly nation, when it comes to increase and multiplication and ministry and outreach and influence and favor and unexpected blessing, when it comes to God building us up and giving us a powerful influence and name, no matter what it is, we have to just simply begin to use the invisible, powerful force of faith in its right context in the blessing of God, and it'll start flowing our way. Praise God. And I want to see it flow for you in 2024. This is a year of reinstitution, recompense. Praise God. This is a year where God is going to turn things around and will turn things around for you. Praise God. And it's a year of evangelism where God will use you as a witness for Christ and to reach the hearts of people. Praise God. And this is going to be a year. And, you know, it's amazing. I was watching online. There's a great woman of God in Toronto, Prophetess Hope, and she prophesied the same thing the Lord gave me. It's a year of recompense and turnaround. Praise God. And restitution. So let's get that promise from God. Let's get that prophetic word this year. And let's get all of these other things. See, because when it comes to finances and all of that, we use that powerful force of faith, it becomes like a vacuum. And when we start doing these three principles I'm going to give you tonight, it's like a magnet or a vacuum that just constantly sucks the blessing into our lives and brings it very close to us. So let's get into it. Without further ado, let's get into it. Number one, very important, it's to getting God's blessing in a particular area of your life, no matter what it is. I've named a few. There's tons of them because the Bible is filled with promises. Number one, you have to find the promise. You have to go and dig for the promise in his word, in this New Testament, in this covenant of God, in this Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, you have to find the promise. And that's the problem with a lot of Christians. They shoot at the hip, and then they create words that are not God's words, and they say things that are not God's ways or God's vocabulary or within God's word and promise. So number one, and one of the ways to walk in the blessing in a particular area of your life, family, is that you've got to find the promise. Hebrews 10:23 says this, "He who promised is faithful." Praise God. He who promised is faithful. The same God who gave us his power to obtain all things in life and godliness is the same God who makes a promise, and he's faithful to fulfill the promise. But we have to find the promise. So I learned years ago from Brother Shambach, if I have a need in my life, in a particular area of my life, let me not go to the left or to the right. Not let me look out secular means or secular ideas, or don't let me look out. He said, don't go looking in other places. Go right and find a promise. He said, I guarantee you it's there covering that particular aspect of your life, because God is concerned about the totality of your life, dear family. So there will be a promise to the need that you have, and there will be a promise in the area in which you need to be blessed. Praise God. There'll be a promise there. We know that. There's promise for salvation. There's a promise for the removal of sin. There's a promise for forgiveness. There's a promise to heal your body. There's a promise to provide for all of your needs. There's promises to prosper you. There's promises to exalt you. There's promises to give you a great name. There's promises for relationships and friendships. The Bible is filled for your home, hallelujah, for ministry, for the anointing, for the call of God, for the purposes of God in your life, for marriage, for children. There's promises in your Bible that that completely fulfill the totality of your very being and life. And one of the ways to be blessed in your life, and one of the key ways, is to go find the promise. You have to go there first, because your faith needs something to grab a hold of. Your confession of faith needs something to grab a hold of. Your praise and worship needs something to grab a hold of. The Psalms is filled with promises. Blessed is the man, the Bible says, in Psalms chapter 1. Just blessed is the man, and in the rest of that blessing that flows in that man's or woman's life. So you have to, again, I'm going to repeat it like a broken record tonight so it sinks in. You have to go find the promise. Don't go look anywhere else. And we're blessed in our generation. We have concordances. We have the internet to type in and look for a particular scripture that has a promise attached to a need or an area of my life that needs to be blessed. Now, what I need to do is go beyond Google, and I have to get it in my spirit and renew my mind with it and change my confession with it. Because a lot of times when we are in trouble, we're flailing. We're just like people drowning in water rather than being people who are floating and safe in the promise of God. And we get angry and we complain and we're frustrated. I get there too, but I have to remind myself, if I want to be blessed, I've got to go find the promise, and there will be that one there. Because God is not holding anything back from us. We don't need to wrestle what we perceive as God's reluctance. We don't have to wrestle with that. God is not slack concerning his promises. God is not holding anything back. He created us to be successful. Right when he created Adam, what does he do? He says, be fruitful and multiply. That's what he tells him. Right when he creates Adam. Now, Adam falls, and God has to deal with that. But God's ultimate desire for us when he made us was to bless us and for us to be blessed. and for us to be fruitful and for us to multiply and us to increase. That's what God desired from the day he made us. So he created us to be successful. I want you to put that up on the screen tonight. I'm so glad you joined me. I wish more would join us tonight, and probably a bunch will watch the video afterwards. But I want you to put up on the screen tonight and get this in your spirit. God created me to be successful. Come on, put that up on the screen. Make that confession of your faith. God created you to be successful. Have you had failure? Sure. Have I had failure? Yes. Have I missed it? Yes. Have you missed it? Yes. Have we had lack in our lives? Absolutely. Have we had tough times in our lives? Yes. But he created us to be successful and to succeed in every aspect of our lives and to triumph over every battle, situation, failure, whatever that we go through. But God wants you and has created you to be successful. Praise God. Successful spiritually, successful emotionally, successful mentally, physically, financially, in relationships, in family. Praise God. In ministry and whatever you set your hands to do and however you live your life, God created you to be successful. And there is a promise for every area of your life once again, and you must go find it. The Word of God is full of promises regarding things that belong to you. Amen. You just got to discover it. You got to discover it because he loves us and he has made provision for us through Christ Jesus. Amen. So whether you have a sick child, whether you have a broken dream, whether you're struggling with a habit, or whether you have a continual sin, or whether you're facing financial difficulty, your Heavenly Father has made a promise and blessings to fulfill those needs. Your job is to go find it. Praise God. I want to encourage you to spend more time discovering the promises of God than anything else. Amen. It's God's pleasure, family, to see us succeed. It's God's pleasure to see us be blessed. He's pleased when things turn around in our lives. And he's pleased when we stand upon his word, claim his promises, as Danny said, and get what he has given to us through Christ Jesus, our Lord. That's why I put that song on. I'm blessed. Amen. So when you have a problem, you go find the promise. Don't talk about the problem. I know I'm guilty of it too, and I need my beautiful wife to tell me, stop it. I need her to tell me to stop it. When the pressures of life come and the pressures of ministry come, she tells me, stop. She's going to remind me. So don't talk about the problem. Don't try to figure it out on your own. And I see a lot of amens on this. And don't try to figure out what you can do about the problem. How about this? Instead of talking about the problem, instead of trying to figure it out on your own, and Danny's saying the same, and others are saying the same, praise God. Don't try to figure out what you can do about the problem. How about this? Go find the promise. Let me say that again. Go find the promise. Help me preach, Crystal, saying amen, and others, praise God. How about you put that up on the screen as other people read your comments? Go find the promise. Hey, praise God, because it's there. Whatever situation's before you right now, family, you need a promise because your faith needs the word to stand on it and your confession needs to kick into it. And the only way the devil can stop you is to take the seed of the word out of you and take the promises of God from you. So go, I love it. Look at that. People putting up there, go find the promise. Anthony just put up there, go find the promise. Stir up your faith, receive all that God has for you, and in those promises that God. Graham's putting it up there, praise God. Number two. Number one was go find a promise. Number two. This one's a tough one. This one we don't like. This one no Christian likes. We like to talk about the blessing in church. Remember I said to you at the beginning, it's highly used, those words, in our Christian vocabulary, and it is highly used in the scriptures, and we love to preach on it, talk about it, sing about it, walk in it, pray about it. But number one, to get to get the promise, you have to find the promise. Number two, you have to heed the correction. That's a challenging one. In order to get blessed and to see the promise of God fulfill in our lives, we have to heed the correction. Isaiah said it this way. Isaiah prophesied it this way. Isaiah chapter 1, you can turn there if you like. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19. I'll read from the New King James Version tonight. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19. Here's what Isaiah prophesied. If you are willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land. That's what he told the children of Israel. If you are willing, you have to be willing to heed correction, and obedient, which means we have to change in order to get blessed, then we'll eat the fruit of the land. So the blessing of God comes when we find the promise and our faith grabs a hold of it. Number two is when we heed the correction. Now, always remember this, family. You're going to find it in scriptures. God's promises, I want you to get this in your spirit, maybe write this down. God's promises come with instructions and corrections. Let me say that again. This is good teaching tonight. God's promises come with instructions and corrections. If you don't take the correction, you don't get the promise. Let me say that again. If you don't take the correction, you don't get the promise. Now, we don't like to teach on this from the pulpit anymore. Do you know why? Because many pastors don't want to correct the church because they're afraid of church people walking out on them and them losing support and the people, and they don't want to have to go through that emotional distress of people walking out on them. It's not always about money. Pastoring is an emotional roller coaster if you let it, because you have people who love you one Sunday and the next Sunday you say something from the pulpit and they're gone. But I'm here to tell you right now, as a pastor, I love you to tell you enough the truth. You will find that the promises of God have instructions and correction and require, praise God, obedience in order for them to be fulfilled. So tonight, again, if you're coming on late, we're talking about the blessing, how to walk in the blessing of God. And you'll find that where you're lacking, as number one point, you go find that promise, you're going to find that there will be a stipulation within those promises. Like salvation has a stipulation. You don't just get it. You have to do what? Peter said, repent and be baptized for the remission of sin. What he said was, turn your life to God, turn from the world, confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, ask God to forgive you of your sin, and you'll be saved. Praise God. Believe in your heart, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and you'll be saved. If you don't do that, you don't get that promise. There's an instruction to the promise. There's a correction to the promise. That is, turn from your wicked ways and turn to the living God. So the promises of God come with, if you don't take the correction, you don't get the promise. When you heed the correction that's attached to the promise, you're going to watch the blessing fall into your life. Now, you're in the kingdom now, so you got to change how you think. Amen. You are in the kingdom now. You have to change how you think. You cannot think like the people in this world. The kingdom has requirements. The kingdom has commandments. The kingdom has instructions. The kingdom has corrections. The kingdom has things that require obedience. If we claim we're in the kingdom and we want the blessing of the kingdom, then we've got to do what the kingdom asks us to do, praise God, in order for it to happen. Amen. So you're positioning yourself for the blessing and becoming a magnet and a vacuum for those blessings and promises with great force. When the Bible gives you full disclosure on how to get them, and that is by heeding the correction that's connected to it. Amen. Here's something people say to me a lot. Why do people give to that person over there? Why is that person always getting stuff from people? Why does it seem like everything works out for them? I get that asked a lot as a pastor over the years. And I have to say it this way. You know, the Bible says, you know, people are saying, I want to get things. Why do people give to you, Pastor, or someone else? Well, I'm not nobody special, and neither is any Christian over above any other Christian. All the promises are for all believers. All promises are for all believers. You got to find those promises. You got to set your faith on them, and then you got to heed the correction there. So people say, well, I want people to do special things for me. Well, the Bible says, give and it will be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men and women give into your bosom. So people will bless you when you are a giver yourself. When you're helping other people, when you're looking for opportunities to be a blessing, when you're pouring your life into other people, it'll come back to you. That the Bible promises that. But you see, you can't get it unless you heed the correction and the instructions that's connected to the promise. Hallelujah. Now, we live in a generation of lawlessness, and that has creeped into the church. We live in a generation in the church where you don't have to do nothing. You don't have to work. You don't have to do nothing. You can just do whatever you want to do. That's not even the Bible. You know, the Bible says we're to work out our salvation. Praise God. The Bible talks about that we have to, faith without works is dead. So you will find that where there's the promise again, your faith grabs a hold of it, and you have to heed the correction. Let's go into scripture real quick, everybody, tonight. I see 100% accurate from Michelle, and amen. Thank you for coming into agreement tonight, everybody, and posting your awesome comments as you usually do up on the screen. Let's go to Mark 11:23. What time do we have here? We got a little time. Mark 11:23 through 25. Let's go look for the promise, the instruction, and the correction in that scripture. So we're going to look for the promise, the instruction, and the correction in the scripture. And you're going to look for that in all of the promises of God now. Amen. You know, the Bible is very clear on this. Of course, give and it will be given unto you in good measure, pressed down, shaken together. Hallelujah. The Bible says we reap what we sow. So let's go to Mark 11. Thank you, AIM, for putting that up, 23 through 25. Jesus, have faith in God. Jesus answered, here's the instruction. Truly I tell you, if anyone says to the mountain, that's instruction, go throw yourself into the sea and does not doubt. So the instruction is, go say to the mountain, be thou cast into the sea. Now, mountain is any obstacle in your way, anything that you face, that you need to triumph over and get the victory over, you're going to have to speak to the mountain. That's the instruction. It's not just going to leave. It's not going to come leave because you talked about it. It's not going to leave because you complained about it. It's not going to leave because you cried about it. It's going to leave because you have spoken to it. That's the instruction. Remember what I said, promises have instruction. Promises have correction. Amen. Instruction and correction. So go throw yourself into the sea and does not doubt in their heart, but believes that which they say will happen. It will be done for them. The correction, does not doubt. Stop doubting. That's the correction. Got to stop doubting upon the promises of God, upon what God has given you as a believer. You have to stop doubting. It does not doubt. If you're doubting, then you've got to change. You got to heed the correction. There's a lot of other scriptures we could go to tonight, but this is one I just picked out. There, he says this, and it shall be done for them. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it. There's the instruction. Whatever, you got to pray. And when you pray, believe. That's instruction. Believe that you receive it, and it's yours. And when you stand praying, here's the correction. Here's a correction in the promise. All right? Here's a correction. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you of your sins. There's the correction. So all of the context of the scripture is, you got a mountain in your way, you need a breakthrough in your life, you need to the victory in your life, you're going to have to speak to the mountain. Correction, don't doubt. If you're doubting, change that and get the doubt out of you. Praise God. The instruction is that when you stand praying, believe that you've received it. That's instruction. And then if you have any odd or anything against anybody, forgive them right there. Forgive them. And that's correction. And it will work. There's a lot of Christians that doesn't work for them. Why? Because they don't believe. And number two is they still hold grudges. And we all battle with that. And some bigger than others because of the situations that they faced. But we all have to get to that place where we're forgiving people. And there's a correction. So people say, well, this doesn't work. Yes, it does work when we follow the totality of what has been asked of us in the context of Scripture. Thank you, Patricia, for your encouraging words. Praise God. So there you go. Now let's go to James chapter 5. Let's look at another one. So number one, to walk in the blessing of God, you've got to find the promise, and there is a promise for that area of your life. I promise you there's a promise for that area of your life, over 1,000 promises in the Scripture. Number two is we're going to heed the correction in order to walk, to have the blessing. So let's go to James chapter 5, verse 14 through 15. And this is a very familiar scripture, as many of you will know it if you've been raised in the church any time for any period of time. Here's what James said in James chapter 5, verse 14 and 15. Is anyone sick amongst you? It's a question. Is there any sick amongst us? And here comes the direction. Ready? And in this instruction. Here comes the instruction. Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. That's the instruction for the promise that's coming. Okay? So again, number one, find the promise. Number two, heed the correction and the instruction that's connected to the promise. Okay? So let them do what? Call on the elders of the church. Stop it. Stop getting upset because the pastor didn't call you wherever church you go to. Stop getting upset because the elder didn't call you to talk to you about your sickness. Stop it. That's not what the Bible teaches us. The Bible teaches us that we are to make the call if we're the ones who are sick. Or have someone make the call for us, like the man who was crippled, and they ripped the roof off of Jesus' house and lowered him down for the Lord to heal him. All right? So stop that stuff. You know, I used to have people tell me all the time, well, Pastor, you never called me. I wasn't feeling good. Well, I didn't know. I didn't know at all. And then they said, well, I'm angry at you. You didn't call. So you know what I started doing? Did you call me last week when I wasn't feeling good? Did you call me and check up on Pastor, see if why I wasn't feeling good? And they said, I didn't know. Okay, well, I didn't know. And the Bible requires for us to make the call. Why? Because it is us taking a step of faith towards the anointing or towards those who will join their faith with us. You know, Jesus didn't go call everybody in their house that was sick. Jairus went and got Jesus. The Roman centurion went and got Jesus. Nahum went and got the man of God, Elijah. So we have to take the step of faith to get the miracle. That's the instruction. I have found in my life of ministry that when I have to chase people down to pray for them for a miracle, it normally doesn't happen. But when those people are chasing me down or another minister down or an elder down or a pastor down, and they're saying, I need you to join your faith with me. I need you to pray with me. I need a miracle. And the Bible says, you know, that you lay hands on the sick and the sick will recover. I want that. They get it. I like what Mike just said. Silly. It is silly. It's very silly. Stop doing that yourself. If you're watching me, watching the video recording, stop sitting in your living room stewing in anger because somebody didn't call you when you all you have to do is call. Pick up the phone and call. Call a friend. Call another believer. Call a brother in Christ. Call the pastor. Call the church wherever you're at. Don't sit there and let the devil put you into bitterness and anger and all of that frustration when all you have to do is make a call and you'll get the prayer. Now, if they don't pray for you, then there's a big problem. If I called a pastor and he said he wouldn't pray for me, Or if I called an elder and they wouldn't pray for me, then that's a different story. Okay? So number one is the instruction to the promises. You have to make the call. Now let's read on. The Bible says, and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. Now the correction. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. There's the promise, but the correction's coming. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well, because we're following the instruction of the promise and the correction's coming. And the prayer of faith will make the sick person, and the Lord will raise them up. And if they have sinned, they will be forgiven. So there must be a confession of sin, of wrongdoing. Sometimes bitterness, sometimes whatever. Sometimes it's not been sin. Sometimes it's an attack. But people don't make the call, follow the instructions. So again, there you go. The correction is, if there's sin in that person's life, then that person should repent of their sins, ask God to forgive them, and allow the power of the anointing to set them free. Praise God. You know, that's it. You know, watching over our words, Lydia. Absolutely, Tatik. Very good. Very good. Because sometimes, you know, let me just say that, you know, that there's the sin of unbelief, and there's the sin of doubt, and there's the sin of unbelief and negative, doubtful confession that we have to repent from too, family. We got to say, Lord, forgive me. I didn't believe. Forgive me for my complaining. Forgive me for my wayward words. That can affect the promise of God. So again, number one, how to walk in this beautiful blessing of God, find the promises that you need. Number two, find the promises and grab hold of them by faith. Number two, heed the correction that's connected and the instruction to the promise. Now, I hope you're going to share this tonight, because this is good teaching. This is good, practical, biblical teaching to walk in the blessing. Okay? Number three. You ready for this one? It is to pray in faith. To pray in faith. Hallelujah. Let me say that again. To pray in faith. Now, faith is confidence. Faith is trust. Faith is belief. Faith is obedience. Faith is yielding. Those are five definitions of the original Greek word for faith, pistis. Now, I'm going to pray trusting God. I'm going to pray, listen to me now, I'm going to pray believing his promise. I'm going to have confidence that it's being fulfilled in my life and God is able to complete it and his word is true, those promises I've found. I'm going to yield to the word of God. Whatever it's asked me to do, I'm going to do. I'm going to yield to the word of God. That faith does that. I'm going to yield to the instruction. And I'm going to obey what God has requested of me. Now, family, I want you to go into the Word after this week and find those promises and look for the instruction, the correction, so that when your faith prays it, you're praying along those lines I just outlined to you, right? Maybe you can put a promise up on the screen right now if you'd like that. That helps fulfill what I just said, all right? Remember what Peter said? People said, how do we receive this gift of the Holy Spirit? Peter said, repent and be baptized for the remission of your sin. And what? Times of refreshing will come from the Spirit of God. The times of the refreshing is the promise. Repentance, baptism, is the instruction and the correction that's needed to get it. Maybe you tonight, family, could find a promise and put the scripture up for us, you know, because it's there. You're going to find instruction and correction, and you have to pray in faith. Faith is the magnet for the blessing. Let me say that again. Faith is the, don't let anybody tell you that faith is not important. Don't anybody tell you that people can have too much faith, or they call it hyper faith, or those faith camp people. Don't get caught up into that. And don't let the actions of a preacher or a person disqualify the truthfulness of the power of faith and the power of the promises of what we're teaching you tonight. Don't let any, Just because a preacher didn't live right doesn't mean the promise of what they said wasn't true. Truth is truth no matter who communicates it, family. All right? So faith is power. That's it, Pastor Lydia. Faith is power. That's why praying in faith is so critical for you to receive the blessings. Christians, let me say this. One of Christians' big failures is prayer. They fail in prayer, not knowing when or what to pray. I wrote this down. There are so many precious believers who don't know how to pray, and they don't have and they don't pray in tongues in their heavenly language, and they don't have it because they haven't asked God to get it, and they pray a mental prayer, their own mental. The moment I hear people say, "Well, I know the Bible says, but," I know they're in trouble. They're in trouble because there's no, "I know what the Bible says, but." It's, "I know what the Bible says, and that's it." I hear people, when I hear this, "I do it my way," that they're in trouble. When I hear people say, "I have my own way to pray," they're in trouble. It's not our way. It's not our own way. It's not what the Bible says, but we got to follow it as the Lord made it. Can I get an amen on that, everybody? We must follow it as the Lord made it. And look at that. Thank you for being humbled tonight. Amen. That's what's dangerous. And that's why the enemy comes in and tries to attack that. Beyond praying in the Spirit, there are right ways and wrong ways to pray. And we, number one, this is why this is why in church I'm like a broken record. Get your hands up. Praise the Lord. Worship and sing the word of God back to Him. Let's just worship the Lord. Let's speak the word. Why? Because when we pray according to the word in faith and obedience, we become vacuums and magnets for the blessing of God, family. So we pray the word. You pray the word. You can never go wrong praying the word. When you pray the word, you are bang on, spot on. So open your Bible up and pray the word. Amen. How about this one? Let's go back to that scripture. My God shall supply all my needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. You can pray that right there. Heavenly Father, I want to thank You that you supply all of my needs according to Your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. God, You're a God who's not limited. And I want to give You praise, and I lay hold of that by faith, that all my needs are being met for Your glory. I'm praying the word. I'm praying the promise. I'm looking for the instruction. I'm looking for the correction. I'm in that word. I'm allowing it to transform and change my thinking. And I'm in an accurate place with God. Come on, family. Then we're in an accurate place with God when we pray the word. Can I get an amen to this? Maybe I need to spend time in the weeks to come just teaching you how to pray the word. And one of the best ways to do this, personalize it. God has no problem with you personalizing the word. Amen. God has no promise. Let's go back to our original scripture, 2 Peter chapter 1, 3. According as the divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and to godliness, I can pray the word. I can pray the word right there. Father, I want to give You praise for Your power. I want to give You praise for Your omnipotent power. And I thank You, Lord, that that power has been given into my life through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I have an anointing from You, Lord, a power from You, from the Holy Spirit. And that power, I want to thank You, Lord, that You've given me all things that pertain to life and godliness, for my spiritual life, for my physical life. In You, I have everything that I need. And God, I want to give You praise. Your power has the ability to perform it. And You're my source. You're my source. See, that's praying the word. So if you're praying and you don't have your Bible with you, or you don't have Bible verses with you, you can go astray. But you cannot go astray when you're in the word. Amen. I see all the wonderful amens. Okay, so we're praying in faith. And when we pray the word, we're in faith. Let's go to another scripture tonight before we get ready to wrap it up. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 12, verse 14. I hope you're being blessed tonight and enjoying it, and you're going to do me a huge favor and share this tonight. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, 12, 14. You know this. This is a prayer of how to draw God's blessing, not only in our personal lives, but in also in a corporate setting and a national setting. You know the scripture. I learned the scripture years ago and never forgot it because 2 times 7 equals 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 equals 14. 2 times 7 equals 14. I remembered the verse. And a dear, oh, precious woman of God who's in heaven, who I love her so much, Margaret Janakta. She was a beautiful woman of God who prayed for me, supported the ministry. And even before I went into ministry, she was just a beautiful blessing as a young man and serving the Lord. She taught me that. 2 Chronicles 7:14. 2 times 7 equals 14. Remember this. If my people, if my people. Now you'll find in taking heed to the correction, you'll find if and when. If you repent. If you do this. When you do this, you're going to be blessed. This one is conditional. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, there is correction. Take the pride out of your lives. The reason why you're not blessed is because you got pride. The reason why there's national problem is because of pride. And that's the truth in this nation. So if my people will humble themselves, praise God. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, there's the instruction and direction again. If they'll pray and seek my face, if they'll humble themselves and repent of pride, there is the correction. There's and turn from their wicked ways. There's correction again. See, it's in every promise. You're going to find it. Turn from their wicked ways. So repent from the what they're doing. Then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin. I will heal their land. There's the promise. Okay? So there's the promise. I'm going to heal their land. I'm going to forgive their sin. That's the promise. But to get that promise, there's instruction and correction. And we've got to pray that by faith. We've got to get a hold of that by faith. Amen. Pride, you're right, Marguerite. Pride is a killer. Linda said, be humbled. Yeah. He who humbles himself shall be exalted. If we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God in due season, he will exalt us or lift us up. It's a promise. There's another promise, but there is an instruction and correction in that promise. And you have to pray along that lines in faith. You got to say, Father, I believe your word. I believe. Here's how we can pray this word right now in faith. Father, I believe that your word is true. Your promises, your yes and amen. I know you hear, and I know you'll hear from heaven. I know you're a God who forgives sins, because the Bible says that if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's 1 John 1:9. I know, God, that you are the God who forgives sin. I know, God, you have the power to heal our land. I've seen it. We've seen it with Israel. We've seen it with other nations. You are a God that can heal a nation. And you're the God that has the power to heal the nation. Now, oh God, I humble myself under your mighty hand. I come to you and you alone for healing. We're praying in faith this scripture right now. And I'm asking you to forgive me of my pride and my arrogance and my self-righteousness. And I ask you, Lord, to forgive me of my wicked ways. And I turn from my wicked ways. And I'm turning to you, the just and the merciful and living God. And I believe you're going to forgive me. I believe you're going to help me. And I believe you're going to heal our land. See? That's praying in faith because you're praying the word, okay? So, number one, how to walk in all of this blessing and blessed and be blessed and have the to be a blessing and be blessed when you're coming in, blessed when you're going out, and to fulfill the promise of God. Number one, find the promise. Number two, heed the correction. Praise God. Follow the instruction in that. And number three, pray in faith. Praise God. And this is an exceeding great precious promise of prayer that God gives us an invitation to, 2 Chronicles 7:14. Faith is a powerful unforeseen force, family. Can't see it, but you can witness. It's like the wind. I can't see it, but I can hear it and I can feel its effects. Same with faith, family. Same with the Spirit of God. Same with faith. Faith is from the Spirit. I can't see faith. and it's an unforeseen force, but I can hear it. I can hear it. I can hear it from the Bible, and I can see its effects. I can feel its power. Praise God. So faith is a powerful unforeseen force, and it is the connector to God. It's the connector to the promises and the blessing, because it's impossible to please God without faith, but with faith, all things are possible to believe. So if we want to be a vacuum, I'm going to finish up now. If we want to be a vacuum, we want to be a magnet, we want to walk in all that blessing, we want to fulfill that Christian vocabulary and those hundreds and hundreds of verses of the blessing of God in our lives, we got to do those three things again. Let's close it out. Number one is, maybe you'll help me put them up on the screen, and let's close it out together. Amen. Thank you, everybody, for all of your for your awesome words. Yeah, Lillian said, faith is the evidence of things not yet seen, but hope for. You got it. You got it, Lillian. Praise God. How about we put up on the screen, okay? The three things that helps us walk in God's blessing. Number one is find the promise. Number two, take heed to the correction. Number three, praise God, pray in faith. Pray in faith. And we'll get it. It'll be there. It will be there. And dig into the Word of God. Amen. Faith gets us to the Father. You got it. Deborah said, thank you, Pastor. God bless you. God bless you, Deborah. Congratulations, I believe, on your retirement, too. You deserve it and much more. Praise God. Well, family, I love you, and I thank God that you joined me tonight. I hope you enjoyed this powerful teaching. It's a very practical teaching, but I want you to have the blessing of God in your life. I want you to walk in God's blessing. You know, again, I told you earlier that there's not an area of your life that God hasn't made a promise to do something in it, and that is true. Go find it. Go get it. And I want you to have it, more importantly, far, far, far beyond. I'm like a speck to the universe in comparison to what God wants for you. God wants so much more for you. And we want you to walk in the blessing. Thank you, Crystal. God bless you for your encouraging words. Hallelujah. So send snow on my way. You can have it all, Pastor Lydia. She's over there in Indonesia. We'll send all the snow and ice you want. Well, God bless you, family. We love you. Remember, you're strong in the Lord and the power of his might. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Every word spoken against you shall fall at your feet. You're the head and not the tail. You're above and not beneath. The Lord's face shines upon you. The joy of the Lord is in you. Power of God lives in you. You're surrounded by angels. You're blessed to be a blessing. You're on a firm foundation. And if God be for you, who can be against you? Praise God. I love you. Thank you for your prayer support. Thank you for your financial support. If you'd like to give, I normally don't ask, but if you'd like to give tonight, you can do that. We don't take midweek offerings. But if you'd like to give, you can go to our website and click on the give icon there, or you can do it through e-transfer, Kingdom Worship Center Ministries at gmail.com. Center as Canadian version, C-E-N-T-R-E. But thank you. If you want to do that, you can. And it helps us, and we thank you for it. I love you. I bless you. I'm praying you have a terrific, awesome, supernatural, spectacular, amazing rest of your week. And may the joy of the Lord be your strength. God bless you, everybody. Have a fantastic night. See you Sunday at 11 a.m.